everyone. Nice to see a great crowd here today. It's nice the rain stopped, so it's easier to make it here. We have Marilyn Waits here from the Redbud Audubon Society. And she's going to talk about grebes and other birds. And grebes are one of my favorites. Before we get started, I will let you know that I think at the end of the program, Jan's going to have the newsletter ready for March. If not, check back or check online. You can sign up for an online newsletter. And the refreshments are provided by the Friends of the Library. They do great things for us, and if you want to join, there's pamphlets there for that. We have some things coming up in March. Can't remember them. I'll go see how far along Jan is, and we'll see if we can get them for you guys. And I'm looking forward to learning about our birds. Thank you.
It's fine for Amy to forget my name because I'm only one of many speakers in this series. You should be very glad, though, I remember my name. The other things I was going to share with you. I'm really delighted to have this opportunity to talk about my favorite birds, and I think probably the favorite birds of a lot of folks in this room, because I see a number of Audubon members who probably in many instances know more about grebes than I do, but none of us ever miss a chance to see them, to watch them, and even to talk about them. So we're very, very happy to be sharing this with you. Let me ask for a show of hands. How many people have seen the grebes on Clear Lake? You haven't. Okay, well, at least you get to see them on video and in photographs today. And then when summer comes, maybe you can go see them out on the lake. I think almost everybody raised their hands. So I may not be introducing a lot of new things to you today, but as I said, these are such amazing birds that any opportunity to see them is really a pleasure. So what we're going to do, we have a video. First of all, let me back up just a minute. We have been doing a conservation project for the grebes of Clear Lake since 2010. So it's actually the seventh calendar year that we're in now. And I'm going to let the video that we'll start with explain why we're doing this. It's actually a grant-supported program. And there are three Northern California chapters doing this because we live on or near the primary breeding lakes for both Western and Clark's grebes in Northern California. And as you'll learn in the video, this project is actually funded by oil spill money. Oil spills that occurred on the coast, not at our lakes. One of them goes back to the late 1950s off the Farallon Islands, right outside of San Francisco Bay. What, almost 60 years later now, it's still leaking oil some of the time, but when it first happened, it had severe impact on the birds in the area. And the other spills were in Humboldt Bay. Our grebes here come to Clear Lake during the summer, and then they spend the winter on the coast, and these spills happened in the winter, which was why those birds were so badly affected by it. And you might have heard the phrase mitigation funds when there's some kind of environmental disaster. The oil companies responsible for the spills pay money to carry out activities that will help increase the future breeding success of the birds that were killed in a particular spill. So there was grant money available for efforts with Western and Clark's grebes here in Northern California. And the State Office of National Audubon wrote a grant that involved our chapter, Altical chapter, which is in the Chico area, and Plumas Audubon chapter, which is up in the Sierras, Chester, and that area up there near Lake Almanor and Eagle Lake. And when the head of bird conservation for Audubon, California first contacted me about this. This was not anything we'd ever done before. We'd never had a grant-supported program coming from outside. And it led to some wonderful partnerships over the years that we've done this. We first of all worked very closely with the county's Department of Water Resources because they have the responsibility for the lake. So you'll see in the video, we did things like we bought buoys so that they could be used to block off the areas where the grebe colonies needed to be protected from boats. They did a sign that you'll see on the Rodman Bridge on the side where boaters coming from the lake need to know to slow down once they get up into the channel. And we have done a number of other things that I'll wait till you see as we go through this. But it has been a wonderful opportunity to take efforts here locally to educate people. And this meeting today is part of that effort because the more people, both residents and visitors who come here, who understand that these birds are vulnerable during the time that they are nesting out in the open, on the lake, in floating nests, and can take steps either as boaters or fishermen or water skiers or jet skiers to be sure that they are not in any way, causing disturbance that would mean non-success in terms of building nests, laying eggs, incubating them, and then taking care of those babies during the first weeks of their lives. So, I think enough of a background. The video that you're going to watch was made during the summer season of 2012 by Dr. Floyd Hayes, who is head of the biology department at Pacific Union College down in Anglin, one of our very active and most expert birders in the Redbud chapter. And Floyd has worked every summer since 2010 with one or two of his interns and occasionally with one of the other birders in Lake County. And every week they have been out there in canoes, checking on the number of birds when they first show up, how soon they start nesting, how many nests, how many adults, once the babies are born, how many chicks. And all of that data that now has been collected through the summers from 2010 to 2016 is going into what is really an international scientific database of grebe researchers. And so it adds actually to research that was done by UC Davis over, I think, probably 4 or 5 years prior to the time that Audubon got this grant. So it's helping scientists learn more about the whole breeding process. And again, ultimately that helps toward successful breeding. So let me put on Floyd's video. And although it was working perfectly fine at home when I checked it, the speakers aren't working. So we've got to cope with just hearing it off of the laptop, which may mean that folks at the back can't hear too well. If there's any way that you can move forward, please do. And I truly apologize because it wasn't supposed to happen that way. Oh, I'll also tell you, about halfway through the video, you're suddenly going to see my face disappear into pixels, sort of like being beamed up in Star Trek. I haven't figured out how to fix that other than asking Floyd for a new copy.
Clear Lake is a large lake in Northern California. It's about 19 miles long and about 8 miles across. The lake is relatively shallow with a maximum depth of about 60 feet. It's the largest natural lake entirely within the state of California. It's a beautiful lake surrounded by many scenic hills. The lake is very popular for recreational boating. The name of the lake is a misnomer. It's not very clear, especially during the summer months when you have large mats of cyanobacteria and algae forming at the surface. Because the lake is relatively shallow, it's highly eutrophic, which means it has high concentrations of nutrients, which are needed by the phytoplankton and zooplankton, which feed the fish, which feed the birds.
When Redbud Audubon Chapter was first formed in 1974, the founding members chose as the logo for this chapter the Western Grebe. Why? Because it is probably the favorite bird of people who live in Lake County and come to visit our beautiful Clear Lake. And people who live here on Clear Lake have loved these birds forever, even if they're not really interested in many other birds. They know about grebes because they're easy to watch on the lake and absolutely beautiful.
I come out here with students each year from Pacific Union College. This is my third summer out here.
I'm Nicholas Drakenberg, and I am an environmental studies major at Pacific Union College.
My name is Daniel Stoppelmore, and I'm also an environmental studies major at Pacific Union College.
Volunteers from the Redbud Audubon Society often help out with the monitoring. There are two large species of grebes that nest out here. The Western Grebe comprises about 85% of the breeding population. It has a black crown that extends below the eye, and a yellow-green bill. This is a Clark's grebe. You can tell by the extensive white on the face extending above the eye and the bright orange-yellow bill. They often hybridize with each other. In fact, about one-third of the Clark's grebes choose a Western grebe as a mate. This is a male Western grebe with a female Clark's grebe. They have a single leg on the nest. This is a possible hybrid sitting on the nest with a bright orange bill. Black does come down below the eye. Western and Clark's grebes nest in large colonies. Sometimes you'll have just an isolated nest out in the middle of nowhere, but normally they like to be in clusters. This particular colony here has about 1,100 nests. Some grebes are seemingly antisocial. This nest is about half a kilometer from the nearest colony. The grebes have some very spectacular courtship displays. The most spectacular is probably the rush display, in which you get two grebes, sometimes three or four, and they run across the water for a long distance, side by side. There's also a weed ceremony in which you have two birds that are presenting weeds to each other, and they're kind of like swimming in circles in an upright position.
That is a weed display between two birds.
Here's a pair of Western grebes just beginning to build a nest. There are two different designs of nests. There are those built along the shoreline in the tules, like this one. Open water nests are simply floating on the surface, and they're attached to submergent vegetation, especially sago pondweed. Some nests are located a long ways from shore. This particular nest is about 950 meters, nearly a kilometer from shore.
There's a little territorial dispute. We've seen Clark's grebe sitting on this nest and Western grebe sitting on it, so a little fight over who controls the nest. So Western grebe is stealing nest material from another grebe. After mating, the male tenderly stomps on the female's head and belly flops into the water. We normally lay about 3 to 4 eggs in the nest. That female Clark's grebe just laid that egg just a few minutes ago. She'd been sitting there for a while. Okay, here's a nest with 8 eggs. 8 eggs is laid by 2 different female birds. This nest had 8 eggs last week. 4 of them are brownish, 4 were blue. The bluer ones are more recent. The brown eggs have been there for a while. They become stained by the water. This nest has 14 eggs. Probably dumped here by multiple females. It's probably an abandoned nest as well. Some birds are very, very defensive of their nests. The male and female take turns incubating the eggs, which take about 23 days to hatch. Here's an egg that is hatching. After hatching, the chick jumps up on the parent. So there's actually one little chick down underneath the feathers in the back of this guy. Little tiny chick with his head sticking out of the feathers in the back of that Western grebe. The number of nests vary from year to year. We think the food supply has something to do with it. The birds feed on fish. Mostly small fish, including some species that have been introduced here. And when there are few fish available, the colonies are often abandoned by the birds. Last year we had 1,248 nests, and at the end of the season we only counted 17 chicks swimming out in the water with their parents around the entire perimeter of the lake. So that was a very bad year. The year before we had a few hundred chicks out of 1,322 nests. There's a number of threats for these colonies. Sometimes motorboats come through the colonies very fast and they can drive right over nests and destroy eggs. The large wakes generated from boats can capsize nests.
Protecting them during this critical period is the point of this 4-year grant that Redbud Audubon is one of 3 Audubon chapters in Northern California who are working on this together.
Audubon California is thrilled to be working with 3 local Audubon chapters, Plumas Audubon, Redbud Audubon, and Alta Cal Audubon, on this grebe project, where we're focusing on outreach, conservation, and monitoring of these threatened colonies on 4 different lakes.
This project that we are doing now is funded by oil spill funds.
So the Luckenbach was a vessel that actually sank outside of the Golden Gate Bridge. In the 50s, it was transporting oil. The funds from the Luckenbach oil spill come from the National Pollution Fund Center, which is a fund that exists for spills that we don't have any company or that we can pursue for damages. So we were able to apply for these funds for restoration projects like the Grebe Restoration Project to compensate for those injuries to the seabirds.
The goals of this project are to educate the public who use the lake for recreational purposes, whether they're boaters or jet skiers or water skiers, to get them to understand that their boat wakes can be dangerous to these birds during the time they're sitting on their nests on the water, and during the period that the babies are first born.
This is a public education campaign by the Redbud Audubon Society for the grebes at a political rally here in Lakeport. I won't say which political party.
And we're out here on Clear Lake at a site where we've set out some protective buoys, some 5-mile-an-hour warning buoys, to warn boaters not to go fast in these areas where there are nesting grebe. We've placed 4 5-mile-an-hour warning buoys across this area to protect the nesting grebes in this area. There are about 40 grebes in this area. We have an agreement with the Audubon Society to do this, and this is a very good program to help promote the nesting and reproduction of the grebes here on Clear Lake. We think that motors and grebes can certainly coexist here on the lake, but we just have to make sure that they know that there are areas where they have to go slow so they don't disturb the nesting birds.
This is a colony of about 1,100 nests, and there are four different buoys here that are set up along the this particular edge of the colony in order to warn boaters to slow down and stay away. Here's a sign telling us to slow down. The fishermen and the grebes basically coexist out here in the lake. This is what we like to see, boats going slowly through a colony. These are waves from a boat that are tossing this nest up and down. Nests are well designed, however, to handle such small waves. Larger waves can be more problematic, and windstorms, natural windstorms, can generate some large waves. We have really big swells here, where there are nests of grebes way out here in the water, long ways from shore. Strong winds can blow a nest free. This nest here we watch float underneath that bridge, and it is actually being blown upstream up a tributary. Last year, we had 200 nests be destroyed by strong winds in one colony. There are river otters that get in here and eat the eggs. Raccoons probably get in as well, and we've watched an entire colony basically be decimated by American crows. There's a crow entering the colony. Danger, danger, danger. Here are some crows feeding on the eggs at a nest. This crow flew off with an egg and carried it to the post, and he's now feeding on it. Here is a California gull feeding on the eggs of a nest. Right here is a chick that did not hatch successfully for some reason. Here's a little chick that died for some unknown reason shortly after hatching. Here's a dead grebe, probably eaten by an owl. I suspect it was ambushed on its nest at nighttime. Introduced species of plants and animals are a potential threat to the aquatic ecosystems here at Clear Lake. The state and county governments are spending millions of dollars to keep hydrilla and other invasive weeds out of Clear Lake. So here are some guys that are contracted to spray for submerged macrophytic plants here in Clear Lake. The airboats are used to spray weeds, and they generate a lot of noise. And we encourage the operators to avoid the grebe colonies. In this case, they have to go sort of right through them, but they're going very slow, which is exactly what they're supposed to be doing. This is one of about 18 nests in a small colony in Rodman Slough. As you notice, the water primrose plants are all brown. They've been sprayed with an herbicide to kill them. This is an exotic species of plant that doesn't belong here. And spraying these weeds probably is not very good for the grebes. The quagga and the zebra mussel are exotic species of mollusks. And at the moment, they do not exist here in Clear Lake. They've wreaked havoc on freshwater lakes across North America. And the state and county governments are spending millions of dollars trying to keep them out of here. And the problem is, if they get in here, there's nothing that eats them. The populations explode dramatically, and they are filter feeders that will filter out all the phytoplankton, at least a lot of it in the lake, and it removes the food for fish and fish-eating birds. So it would dramatically alter the ecology of Clear Lake. This is Sulphur Bank Mine, located at the southeast end of the lake. It was an active mercury mine in the late 1880s, and for several decades, a lot of mercury leached into the lake. This particular pit here is highly acidic with a pH of something like 2.6. And the mercury has biomagnified into the fish and the fish-eating birds, including grebes. This is considered a Superfund site that the federal government has spent millions of dollars trying to remediate.
I'm standing here on the deck of a private homeowner here on Clear Lake, and this is part of the most exciting step that we've had in this project to try and educate the public about grebes. We have just set up a web camera on a group of nesting grebes.
This is a webcam, and it's focused on the activities of a pair of western grebes that are nesting right here. The webcam is focused on a nest, and I could watch the activities at the nest from my office.
It's a wonderful opportunity. People love watching these birds. They are among the most beautiful and most fascinating that you could ask to work with. A brief PowerPoint that talks about some of the things that we've done since 2012 when the video was made. And get this on slideshow. Okay. So over the whole period of this grant, there are a number of different ways that we have tried to reach out to the public. And I'm just going to take you quickly through that. Some of these are really permanent gifts to Lake County, and one of those is that at five different parks, one state park, two county parks, the city of Lakeport and Library Park, and the city of Clear Lake and Redbud Park, we have been able to put up a permanent interpretive panel that both describes the unusual activities of the birds, and then explains, in terms of boaters and so on, how to help the birds be protected during breeding. Another thing that we have done, and actually we've been doing this for 22 years, counting the upcoming Heron Days event, we take people out on pontoon boats on Clear Lake from two different locations that are close to heron rookeries, where those birds are nesting at treetops. Again, they're colony birds like the grebes, so there will be groups of them. And particularly, I can remember in 2004 and 2005 when we had somewhere between 30 and 50,000 grebes on Clear Lake.
Wow.
We were able to not only show people the nesting herons, but they were able to watch these early stages of the grebe breeding process. In other words, they got to see the courtship display. And for people who've never witnessed anything like that, I mean, there are not, offhand, I can't think of any other birds, maybe loons, that actually can hydroplane on the surface of the water, and much less do it in synchronized pairs where they are exactly doing the same thing. So people would just be blown away, right? And some people would say, well, you ought to call this the Grebe Festival. And we said, I don't think that would work. Non-birders would think, what is that? Snails, maybe, or something, an insect? But it is quite an amazing opportunity. And especially for people who don't live on the lake or get out on the lake, have their own boats or friends with boats, this is a really special opportunity. Each of the boats is guided by an Audubon guide, and here's Pat Harmon sitting in our audience.
And so it's a really special experience because you have an opportunity to really learn about the various birds that you see. And then we also have had a wonderful way of reaching people by going to the different festivals and community events around the whole county, where there's an opportunity to have an exhibit booth and people can stop and actually see things, take away some information, and have somebody to answer questions. So we've done that everywhere, obviously Heron Festival, a key one, but Pear Festival here in Kelseyville, Olive Festival in Kelseyville, Earth Day down in Middletown, Wild West Days over in Upper Lake, and then again, Middletown Days. And that's been a booth, information materials. And then I brought with us today the two wonderful wooden models, life-size of grebes, one of a Clark's grebe and the other of a Western grebe. And the Clark's has a baby on its back. So don't forget to walk over to the table over there and take a look. And then I think one of the most long-lasting valuable things we've done, and Rob Patton, who's sitting right here in the front row, gets almost 100% of the credit for this because he was with several of us at one of the once-a-year grebe team meetings. This one was up at Chester, hosted by Plumas Audubon. And we were standing on shore there. We had gone to both of the lakes that they have been working with. And we saw offshore a grebe that just kept diving continuously and couldn't figure out what was going on. So everybody started training their binoculars on it. And we could then see that a huge mass of fishing line was caught on its back foot, and it could not get free of it and kept diving trying to do so. And it happened that part of our group there are fish and wildlife biologists who are certified to deal firsthand with, you know, helping wildlife. And the boat was there and they went out and they had like a net kind of thing, you know, fishing net. And they were trying to get close enough to catch it and get it on board, and the thing was so frightened that, you know, it just kept moving further away. So they were not successful in getting it. This is a photograph. If you look on the back, you can see that tangle of line, and it actually got caught through its beak.
Aww.
So, you know, birds don't live when something like that happens. And so Rob and Janet Swedberg, who preceded me as chapter president, were standing there. And again, serendipity in life, right? Janet says, you know, when I was visiting my daughter on Lake Erie back east, I saw a really good idea, which was they had a metal thing that fishermen could put their used line into. And that would prevent problems like this. And Rob says, gee, do you have a photograph of that? And Jen says, actually, yes, I did take one. So he said, send it to me. I think I could, you know, probably come up with something like that that we could try using here at Clear Lake. He did, and I think it was at least a month or two later that Rob found out that there actually is a national program that here in California is run by the Coastal Commission that provides easy specs for building one of these recycle bins. And they are tracking where these are. So quarterly, Rob sends in a report. And the interesting thing, we happened to develop a partnership with the Sea Scouts troop. And so they were helping, because we now have 21 of these around the lake at all of the parks, at many of the resorts that particularly specialize in, you know, having fishermen come there. And I'll show you what these look like, okay? It's a tube. Rob builds these. They do need somebody to construct them. And he has worked with every one of the jurisdictions, because again, to put it in a public place, you have to have permission to do that. and with the resort owners. And over the years, I mean, I think we started with what, maybe a dozen the first year?
I think so. I think it was 12 we put up at first. And if anybody knows of any place where somebody would like to have one, we're still putting them up anytime we find a good place to set one up.
And the interesting end product here is that the fishing line that's collected all goes to Rob, whoever the volunteers are who actually, you know, go in and retrieve it, and it gets sent to a manufacturer in Wisconsin that uses that to build new plastic products. In other words, doesn't just get tossed out, it's recycled effort. So
we've sent about 20 pounds of it back. So 20 pounds of fishing line is a lot of fishing.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. So again, any fishermen or fisherwomen that you know, make certain that they know about these and that they make use of them, okay? And any kids you know, tell them not to put trash in there because it just complicates the collection process. And then you heard Gary talk and Floyd in the video. We purchased 20 of these speed limit buoys and gave them to the Department of Water Resources because, again, we were asking them to take on doing something they had not done previously. And so these have been used to put protection around the colonies. And then the boating signs, okay? These small signs, which are about like this, and they're a hard permanent plastic, these are in the various bait shops around the lake. So again, it's directed to the boaters and fishermen, telling them why they need to avoid the Grebes and so on. And then you saw in the video, this sign, the Department of Water Resources actually put this one together, and they put it up at the beginning of the season, and then they take it down for the winter. But it's there during the time that people need to know about it. So these things, the interpretive panels, the recycle bins, the buoys, and our Grebe models, all of these are permanent parts of what are helping to educate people in Lake County and to protect colonies very directly. Okay, so just a bit of repeat or repetition here. Detour, if you're out there in a boat, detour around the Grebe colonies, avoid anything that would cause a collision. Respect the buoys. Pack out your trash, including that fishing line. Educate others. Help keep, as we said here, common birds. Keep them common here in Lake County. Okay. All right. I brought not just show and tell, but actually some things you could take home. And I particularly want to call your attention. We put together this little brochure, which again, you know, we have anytime we do a presentation. And it covers a lot of the key information. First of all, I'll get you a little photos here so that you can tell that difference between a Western and a Clark's Grebe. And then talks about their behaviors and how to protect them. Then I also, this isn't our brochure, but this is really interesting and useful information. Particularly, you know, have this at home when you get visitors because it is a history of the lake and talks about what's really special about this as a natural lake. So you're welcome to that. And then, not Grebe, but Audubon and Lake County birds. We've got a handout on the various kinds of seed and feeders that are appropriate for certain kinds of birds. And hummingbirds, everybody's maybe second favorite bird, right? So this talks a bit about how to attract them to your home. And then this is a good one that tells you ways that in your own yard and garden, there are things you can do that will help nature, whether it's birds, specifically birds, obviously, but in general, helping out. And I brought a few copies of our membership form in case you're interested. Let me just talk for a second about Audubon, the organization, and how our local chapter here, which has been here since 1974, fits into a larger picture. National Audubon covers the entire country, works with Canada and Mexico and South America in terms of the entire migration route for our birds here. Some go north, some go south, but they go all the way to the Arctic Circle, and I'm not sure to the Antarctic, I don't think so, but certainly to the tip of Chile in some cases. And I mentioned our state office, which without which we would not have been able to do this project, you know, helping our Grebes. Ours is one, I think, of the most effective offices in terms of the Audubon network. There's some critical work going on with birds at the coast, the Salton Sea. There were efforts earlier with Mono Lake. There was a wonderful effort. There is a tricolored blackbird that nests in the Central Valley. And, you know, 90% of all the wetlands in California have disappeared over the last century and a half because that land has been farmed or developed for housing and towns and so on. And so these birds now, they're fewer in number, and they are ground nesters. And they now use the farmers' fields where they're growing hay for dairy farmers. And they were encountering a problem that the point at which their chicks were hatching and were tiny fledglings, there was the same time that in some cases the farmers needed to harvest that grain. And so for several years, Audubon has raised money to purchase hay as an alternative so that they could hold off for, you know, a week or maybe 2 weeks until the birds had actually fledged and were not any longer on the ground. So conservation efforts like that to help birds take a very wide range of what needs to be done and can be done. But Audubon is a combination of both a lot of impressive scientists at our local level, as you saw with Floyd, all the way to the national level with the director of bird conservation. But the other thing that is so powerful about Audubon as an organization is its volunteers, like folks around the room here who are Audubon members who do activities, who, you know, give their time like Rob did to be in his home garage constructing those and then going out and talking to people. And then the follow-up work to simply once a quarter be going out there to collect that fishing line and then send it off. And thanks to the internet and that development over the last, you know, 15 years or so, there is now within Audubon a really powerful email system that sends information out to people when they need to know about a particular bill that's been proposed, either to support it or oppose it, and easy ways to contact legislators. I'm pretty enthusiastic about Audubon because I've seen within Lake County and at those higher levels some really committed work that has been effective to help protect birds. So, open to questions. Terry.
Okay, a couple things. I did a story on Western Grebe for Bay Nature magazine several years ago, and I talked to the professor from the University of Washington who got his PhD on Grebes. And a couple things is, one of them is that, after I talked to him, I looked at it, how the little ones get on their mother's back. They put their foot out, and they actually step on the foot. That's one of the ways they get up, just like a stair. And I've watched him do this many times.
Yeah.
Another one is
where the parent puts out the back.
Yeah, the parent puts out the foot. The parent does. And then Another one was I went out on the lake with some scientists from the university, from the federal government Fish and Wildlife Service. And they were checking mercury levels in grebes because they eat so much fish. And I didn't know how they were going to do this. We went out at night, actually, with a light and netted the grebes with long-handled nets. And grebes would sit still when the light was on them. And the way they got the blood out of them, they took a needle and they pushed it in the heart. And I thought it'd kill them, and it doesn't kill them at all. And they got the blood, and it was, and that's how they did samples. These were all biologists stuff. I thought that was pretty neat, because I thought I'd, you know, put a needle in, it would kill you instantly. Well, anyway, this professor, I was out talking to him one time, and I said, how do these grebes migrate? Because I never see them fly. We never see big flocks of grebes fly. And he had a great sense of humor. He said, they walk. And I said, what do you mean they walk from Washington here? He said, have you ever seen them fly? I said, no. He said, well, they must walk. But actually, they do, many of them fly at night. And they do work down. And he said what they do when they get to California here, this is why you have a big buildup of grebe for 1 year and very few the next. He said they hit all the lakes and they look for food. And if there's enough food, they stay. If there's not, they have to move on. And I noticed that about 3 years ago. I was over at the Indian Valley Reservoir fishing, and the shad were massive over there. They were so thick. Grebes were everywhere. There was thousands of grebe. They were, none of them were nesting. They were just feeding because there's not the potential to nest there. So they're really, they're a fascinating bird, and everything changes all the time with wildlife, you know that.
Yeah.
And there is no real positive thing, but the biggest thing to me for grebes, what's interesting, is how they migrate, because you never see, you know, we see all these other big birds with big flocks come over.
Yeah.
You never, I've never seen a grebe fly over a foot off the water, maybe 20 yards, and that's it, you know. But they actually do fly, and they migrate down that way by flying.
Thank you. For those of you who've read his wonderful articles but never met him, that was Terry Knight, who is one of our treasured wildlife writers for Lake County. Hi, yes.
You're a treasure, Terry.
Do you still take people out on the boat?
We do, yes. He asked whether we still take people out on the pontoon boats. We do that in the spring, the last weekend of April and the first weekend of May. Okay, it's called Heron Days. And this year we're actually doing it for a total of 4 days. It's been in the past, like 1 day up here, which is at County Park in Kelseyville, Lakeside County Park. And then in past years we've been using Redbud Park in Clear Lake and then going across the lake into the you know, Cache Creek area there. This year we're going to be actually at Shady Acres campground, which is already right there at the entrance to Cache Creek. So we're not going to have to cross the lake, which is good because we've had problems with the wind kicking up in the past, and it takes quite a long time in a pontoon boat to get across the lake and then back afterwards. So there'll be information in the papers about that. And you can go online to our website. I think the tickets are going to open in first part of March. So that is a wonderful opportunity.
I'd like to add one thing for Audubon is go to their, when they have bird tours and walking, it's a fascinating. They had one here a while back, and Brad and Kathy and Pat put it on at the county park. And I'm out at the county park all the time, and they were counting species. It was open to the public. I think they ended up with 78 species of different species of birds at the county park. I couldn't believe it. And they were counting little, even little tiny ones you never see. You know, I mean, what an educational trip that was. I mean, it just awed everybody.
Yeah, thank you. In terms of our activities here in Lake County, our active program year starts September, ends with picnic in May. And once a month there is a meeting where we have a speaker, and we brought in some really amazing speakers a couple times where we used the Soperese Theater, and you know, it was a big event. Most of them are smaller meetings, but always with good, interesting speakers. And for the September through December meetings, we are at the Social Hall of the Catholic Church on Main Street in Kelseyville. And then January through April, we are at the social hall for the Methodist Church in Lower Lake. And so that way, wherever you live in the county, at least for half of the year, you don't have as far to drive as you do for the other half. And then, as Terry just mentioned, we have a field trip every month. It's the Saturday following the chapter meeting, and those chapter meetings are the third Thursday of every month. And the field trips, sometimes they're here in Lake County, wonderful places to bird like Clear Lake State Park or Rodman Slough, the county park occasionally, and then some interesting trips away, one of which I really recommend to people because it's such a phenomenal experience, and that is our January trip where we go to the Colusa and Sacramento Wildlife Refuges. And you can go there anytime on your own. The Sacramento Wildlife Refuge is actually a driving tour. You're kind of up on a levee, and then there are three places along the way where you can pull over and stop and get out and get on a platform where they have the really big scopes. What is phenomenal about that? Migration patterns again. During the winter months, California gets huge numbers of birds who come to spend the winter here. Ducks, every kind of duck there is, not truly true, but all the ones that come to California, but we're talking thousands and thousands of birds, and it's just really an amazing experience to see that firsthand. So what didn't I cover?
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
On the, you've got the Clarks and the Westerns, you say they're breeding together?
Yes.
Does the young one declare what it is?
Well, it probably went by too fast, but Floyd showed a photo of a bird that had, that looked Western because the black went beneath the eye, but the bill was that definite orange yellow rather than the, you know, softer yellow that, that the Clark would have. So I don't know they have to declare themselves to one another, but yeah, I'll get mixed up.
Well, they give them two names, but isn't the fact that they can interbreed a sign that they are actually one genetic group?
Yeah, they used to be one.
I think that is true. Yes.
Yeah, I think they're actually cousins.
In years past, they used to take the, it seems to me anyways, they would take the heron days out Rodman Slough. Because I know last year my husband and I, we went out there and to go back through, because there was so much water, just like there will be this year, to go through all those waterways, there'd be tons of herons, the cormorants, the egrets nesting up there. It's just amazing to see all what's back there. It's just another world. It's if anybody ever has an opportunity to go back and see that.
I think what you're actually talking about is the channel at Corinthian Bay.
No, it's, it was Rodman Slough.
Okay, because I don't believe at heron days, we've not been able
that?
To take those pontoon boat. I don't even think a pontoon boat can get under the bridge that separates
the town.
But what you're describing is true both at Cache Creek and at that channel there.
There was
that
like
we
four
usually
channels.
Go into at Corinthian Bay, because then you're in a channel, so you know you're close to both sides, and you see birds, not just nesting herons and egrets, but you'll see things like green herons, yellow-headed blackbirds. Pat, you want to toss a
can of the teens?
Mudbirds.
Swallows. A lot of swallows.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, if there's no question, being able to be out on the lake in a boat or a canoe or what else?
Kayak.
You know, you appreciate this incredibly wonderful nature place we live in a way that those of us who don't have a boat and live on shore, we don't get to see it in quite the same way. So I really encourage you. You have a friend, insist they take you out on the boat. Any other questions? Yes?
Not so much a question as just, last year we had a nest right in our channel, which was thrilling. And so we watched and watched, and they traded off on the eggs and everything, and worried about feral cats, and they survived through all of that. And I didn't realize they had actually two little babies. I didn't realize there were two because I saw one, and one had a red dot right here, and the other one was on the other adult and did not. So I didn't want to tell people what that's about.
You know what? Thank you, Gay. That will let me. We actually try not to handle these too much because our hands, of course, have oils. But here's the Clark's grebe with the baby on its back. And this carving came from a carver who lives just outside of Sacramento. The other one came from Eastern Canada. Again, thanks to the internet. Our colleague from the Chico chapter found that, and so each of us ordered one. This little blood spot here is what Gay is talking about. You see the little red spot on the baby's head? When we first got this, I thought somebody spilled nail polish on this, right?
Show him this.
Oh.
See that?
See the baby on the back? Under the feathers, okay? What I have been told since is that this is a blood spot that becomes prominent. In other words, it's not there and then it is there. And it is a signal to the parent who's coming back with a fish, I'm hungry, feed me. Because remember, there might be other babies, you know. I've never heard any of our folks say that they have seen more than one baby on a back have this at the same time. I don't know. I mean, a lot of people didn't even know what this was, which also goes to say, one of the things about getting interested in birds is you will probably never get to the point that you know everything there is to know about birds. I mean, that's why people get fascinated. You know, my own story, we moved up here from San Francisco 20 years ago, and I'd never been interested in birds. I always lived in cities. I knew robins, crows, pigeons. That was sort of it. And our first year here, my husband bought a big stone bird bath for our garden, and it's right outside the window where our office is. And we put up a feeder. And the bird that did it for me was a spotted towhee, which, you know, there are things like wood ducks. You can't even believe that nature did that. It's like somebody painted those patterns and colors, right? Spotted towhee is basically black, brown, and white, but the patterns are quite amazing. And that bird bath is no further than Claire, okay? When I'm sitting at my desk, so I look out and see this bird, and it's like, whoa, I thought you had to go to Central or South America to see something like that. And it happens, Suzanne Schultz was one of my first friends I made up here, and she's a longtime Audubon member and, you know, board member and so on. And so she kind of got me interested. And I'm still not a birder. I mean, I know very little compared to most of the folks, but that's, again, the value of going on the field trips, because you learn. Other people do know what it is, and it's bird behaviors and colors that hook me. And as you've seen with these grebes, those behaviors can be just phenomenal. And the fact that right here in the center of our county, we have things that people would come from other parts of the country to actually be able to see firsthand. So, yeah, they're pretty fascinating. And thank you, Gay. Yeah, Terry?
One other thing, too, I found out that, you know, when they have all their little ones and they're all together and the adults are diving for food, and when they come up, how that little one finds the mother, because he'll come all the way through a flock. I've seen him come through a dozen grebes. And I was told because when they're in the egg, the parents are constantly chirping to them, and there's a little bit of difference in each one, and these, when they're hatched, they recognize that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's how they find them, because I couldn't figure it out. I sat and watched it for hours like that. A baby grebe will be 20, 30 yards away where the parent comes up with food, and it goes right through everyone and goes right to it. And there's hundreds of these little babies around up there.
Yeah.
How can they do this?
The other time you think of that is when you're watching one of those videos of penguin colonies, right? And the mother comes back after getting the food, and, you know, dad's been taking care of that chick. and the mother finds the right baby. That's an even more crowded colony than what we have with our grebes. Yeah. Yes?
What is that a photograph of?
This?
Screensaver.
You'd have to ask Windows.
I thought it was part of the white feathers.
It looks like rocks.
This is the chapter laptop. And I think that was just one of the choices that, you know, somebody said, okay, let's use that. No, okay. No. You've probably been sitting here through the whole thing wondering, right? Yeah, right. Yeah, a little different shot of Canocti, right? Other questions?
One other thing, too.
Yeah.
On the birds that we all wonder why grebes abandon their nests, and it's because of lack of food. Nature said if you can't feed them, you can't have them.
That's right.
And so when we've had years here when redfin shad and the silversides have been way down, you know, you see a lot of grebe nests like out around the county park and some of the sloughs here, and then they're abandoned. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why, because nature said, okay, mm-hmm. you can't hatch it because there's not enough food for them here.
Yeah. And, you know, as a non-scientist, I've wondered, so how do they know? Because they've started. They've built the nest. They've laid the egg. They've been incubating it. How do they know that it's not going to be worth continuing? And I have no idea if this could be the answer, but it makes sense to me that when the parent gets off the nest and it has to swim some distance to find food, that has become an evolutionary way that the length of time it takes them to find food signals them to say there's not going to be enough for those babies when they're born, and so they stop.
A few years ago, we lost our minnow population here, and I remember I was out at Long Tule Point around the edge where that heavy nesting area.
Yeah.
I counted over 30 nests that were abandoned there. Mm-hmm. And, the eggs were still in there. I went up slowly to each one and looked down with binoculars and everything. There wasn't an adult grebe around them at all.
Yeah.
And that tells you something right there.
The windstorms here have been a real problem in recent years, too. Floyd's got photos, I think it was season before last, 2015, that a huge number of nests over along the east side of the lake were destroyed by wind. And you just saw all these eggs floating in the water.
You're going to have that next week? They're predicting high winds next week.
Yeah. Yeah, but see, we're not to nesting season yet, so.
Oh, good.
No effect from that. Yeah.
How long do grebes live?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. I don't know. I think maybe around 15 years. I'm not sure.
I think that's a lifespan. The average grebe only lives about 6 or 7 years.
Okay.
They can live to that. But it's like anything in a wild, or just like a human,
right.
We only live a portion of the lifespan.
Yeah. They're not like 50-year birds, of which there are a number of species. Okay?
Well, I was just thinking also, for me, in learning to identify birds, there's three grebes around here that you can really hear the difference. One is the western grebe. They go, greedy, greedy. They do two. And the Clark's grebe just goes cree once. Okay, so if you're hearing birds and they're doing cree cree, those are western grebes. If they're just doing cree cree, those are Clark's grebes. And then the grebe that I never knew made it sound like this at all. It's the pie-billed, which sounds like every jungle movie you ever heard of.
And they're little. Right, so if it's a big sound.
And they're like submarines, they can just go straight down the water. But those are the three grebes you hear around here.
Yeah.
We get some others in the winter when we don't have them.
Yeah, the pike-billed grebes and the horned grebes, you don't see them very much. They tend to stay hidden, and they're smaller to begin with. And they tend to be like in the creeks and the channels at Clear Lake, not so much out in the open. I mean, again, we're so fortunate with these grebes we're working with. They're big enough that even from a distance you can see them. And, you know, again, because they're in groups, there are other birds that are totally solitary, so there's one, and if you don't happen to be looking where it is at the moment, or else it flies very quickly. And as Tim said, when they're here, our grebes are staying put. They're on the lake. So. I have to make one more comment back to something that Floyd showed in the video. I mention frequently when I'm presenting this, especially to groups of young people, that these birds are very egalitarian. You know, they both work to build the nest. They take turns sitting on it. They both bring food to the babies. I don't point out that mating behavior of stomping on the female's head and stepping right over her, but it is interesting.
Been there, done that.
Okay. Any more questions?
I just have one.
Yeah.
When I moved here in 98, in the middle of the night, I heard whoop, 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 whoop. What would that be?
That's a pie-billed.
That sounds like a pie-billed.
That's a pie-billed?
Do you live on the lake, Beth?
I did.
Yeah. Well, just think of the jungle yell.
Well, I thought maybe it was a whooping crane, so yeah. I went, no, they don't come here. So.
That's where it's helpful if you're getting interested in birds. We have a bird checklist for Lake County. It costs $2. You can get it anytime, you know, at any one of our meetings. And it'll list by species each bird that we've seen here in Lake County, but it will identify whether that bird is common or, forget the order, frequent or rare or extremely rare. And it'll do that by season because, like with the grebes, you're not going to see grebes here in January, most likely. Might be an occasional one that's decided to stay year-round. But it helps you kind of narrow down, like Beth said, oh, look at the checklist. That bird doesn't even come to Lake County, so that wasn't what I was seeing. So it helps with that process of becoming more familiar with what you're seeing. The nice thing is, you don't have to know what its name is mm-hmm. to be able to appreciate either the beauty of a bird or the interesting behaviors that they do. So you can be a complete amateur and still love birds. All right, and you've been a terrific audience. Thank you.
Thank you.